Thank you for honouring Amy Jane, and in that I believe you've honoured Jesus. One of the things I think all of us were working through yesterday was how could God allow Amy and her family to go through this tragedy, through this difficult. And here's the premises. We all believe that God loves us, that God cares for us, and we all believe that God can do anything, which leaves us with this question, so why didn't God who loves us, why didn't he save Amy and her family from having to walk through the pain of what they've walked through in this last period of time? And I think the unspoken application underneath that is also this thought there, and so why doesn't God save us from the pain that we have to walk through? Why doesn't God save me from my difficult situations, my broken relationships, my frustrations with my employer, my struggles with my health? If God can do anything and he loves me, then why doesn't he change my circumstances? Why doesn't he answer my prayer? Why doesn't he do more in my life? I don't know that I've got a full answer to that today, because that's a really big question, but I've got some thoughts I'd like to leave with you. Jesus spent his 3.5 years before his death in intensive ministry. He travelled the length and breadth of his country, speaking, healing the sick, teaching his disciples how to do what he was doing. He spent his time there challenging religious people and the religious systems, and he was often exhausted by the intensity and the output of what he was actually doing. And in the midst of all that, it seems like he had some friends he would visit when he needed to recharge. Ministry was intense for him, and he would often be pouring out of his life into the lives of others, and it seems that he would withdraw from time to time to a place where he could recharge his spiritual batteries, his emotional batteries, recharge himself. And the place where he seemed to do that fairly often was at the home of 3 siblings, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. It seems that he and his disciples would call in on their way back and forwards across the country. They would call in and say, "Hey guys, we're here. Can we stay for a couple of nights? Can we have a cup of tea? Can we have some meals together? Let's have a chat." And it seems like there was one sort of relationship between Jesus and his disciples, which was a disciple-mentor-mentee relationship. But it seems also with these 3 siblings that there was a deep friendship that had developed with them over the years. They became friends. Well, one day Jesus was ministering not too far away from where they lived, and he had an urgent message come from Mary and Martha. And they said to him, "Jesus, come quickly. Your friend Lazarus has fallen extremely sick and has nearly dead. And we think if you don't get here, if you don't bring the healing power that you have with you, we believe that Lazarus is going to die." So the disciples, they urged, "Come on, Jesus, we need to go. We've seen you in action. We know what you can do. We know how much you love Lazarus. We need to head off now." But Jesus, listening to the Holy Spirit, Jesus listening to the voice of his heavenly Father, has this stop. No, don't go, Jesus. Stay where you are. And the Bible tells us that Jesus stayed for 3 days. And in that time, Lazarus has actually died. He's had some sort of ceremony. He's been wrapped. He's been put in a grave. Stone's been rolled across the front of that tomb. And then after 3 days, Jesus then says to his disciples, "Okay, let's go and visit Lazarus." We know the story really well. As Jesus approaches the village and then the graveyard where mourners are still in grief, Jesus himself is overcome with emotion. Jesus himself, at the loss of his friend, at the death of his friend, finds himself emotional. He's visibly upset. His friend is gone. And to the point where the onlookers say, some of the Pharisees, some of the leaders say, "He, Jesus, must have really loved Lazarus. Look how upset he is." And Jesus was upset. And death is always upsetting. Death is always a tragedy. It wasn't an original part of God's plan for us, but it came in through sin. It came in through disobedience. And so death is now a part of our life, but death is tragedy. And Amy Jane's death last week was a tragedy. Tragedy for her family, tragedy for her loved ones, tragedy for her church, tragedy on so many levels. And so here's the question that I found myself contemplating. So where was Jesus? Where was he in all of this? How do we hold our faith and trust God when tragedy strikes? And Jesus said this about his followers, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Have you ever felt like, Jesus, where are you? Ever felt like you're in the middle of a circumstance that you didn't see coming? And one of the questions you have there is, Jesus, where are you? Have you lost my address? Have you forgotten where I live? Can't you see the pain that I'm in, the difficulties that I'm facing, the challenges that is in front of me? Jesus, where are you? If you'll never leave me nor forsake me. And I was thinking about Amy and Anthony, and Amy and Anthony live in Townsend, which is down near McLean Yamba, and she was being treated at Lismore Base Hospital. So often they would drive up for treatment and then drive back. And then towards the end, Anthony would drive up by himself and then drive back. And I'm sure as they were driving to the hospital on some days, there were a little voice and little fears that would be gnawing at the edge of their hearts. And on one hand, fear and an anxiety knocking on the door of their hearts, trying to get in. This is not going to turn out well. And this is not going to be good. And anxiety and fear about what the future could look like. I'm sure that was an option that's there for all of us. But on the other side, you have this relationship with Jesus. And I'm sure, and I spoke to them many times, and often Anthony, on his way home from the hospital, he'd call me up and talk about how the day had gone and how the treatment was going. And you know, on those situations, I never had him in despair. I never had him say, I'm so angry with God. He never said that. He said, I have no idea what's going on here. I'm so frustrated. He never said that. He talked, though, about the goodness of God. He talked about how he and Amy felt the peace of God in their world. He talked about how they felt comfort in their hearts and their soul. And they talked about how Jesus was a source of strength to them, to the point that the doctors and nurses there often would wonder, and they'd say, what is it with this Amy girl? What is it with this Brown family? We see people here often in these circumstances and they're going to pieces, but you're actually being a strength to us. You're actually encouraging us. You're actually taking an interest in us and our world. And how could they do that? Because Jesus was there with them. How often is it that God doesn't remove us from our challenging circumstances, but instead walks beside us as we take the courage to trust him and keep on going? Isn't that so true sometimes? We just pray and want God to change the circumstances, but Jesus has said, no, I'm not going to change the circumstances, but I'll walk with you. I'll talk with you, I'll give you strength, I'll give you comfort, I'll give you encouragement, and together we're going to go through this thing to the other side. On the morning that Amy passed away, I got a call that she had actually died. And that was just devastating. We hadn't expected to have that call. Anthony had been up there the day before, and he expected to come back the next day. The oncologist had been there, and they talked about some new treatment and another trial that could go ahead. And so the oncologist was expecting Amy to keep on going, and they were expecting her to turn the corner at any moment to see a reversal in how things were going. And so when we received this call, when I received this call on about 8:30 on Friday morning, I was just devastated. Oh no. And so we were in the middle of our holiday break, and we'd had 2 weeks of holiday. We're supposed to have 4 weeks, and here I was in thongs. I had an old pair of jeans on, a dirty old t-shirt, haven't shaved for 3 weeks. It was a good t-shirt. Thank you. Carolyn wants you to know it was a good t-shirt. I did have a shower that morning, so I was reasonably, you know, okay. And I'm going to go up to the hospital. So I was in Ganellabar, actually, and so I was only just 10 minutes away from the hospital, so rocked up to the hospital, and I got to where the ward was, and the lady looks, are you the minister? Yes, I am the minister. Can you show me where they are? So we went into the ward there, and here's Amy. She'd passed. He was Anthony and Anthony's dad and myself, just the three of us. But you know the amazing thing in there? Was the sense of peace that we felt. The sense of, it was like a blanket of peace was over there. Now, it was raw, pretty emotionally raw. I was pretty emotional. Anthony was, like, he was distraught, as you would be, and John was there. We were all upset. But it wasn't that upset where it's a despair of hopelessness and a sense of being upset and woe is us. It was an upset because we were separated from her. She had gone. But at the same time, there was this sense of God's peace in the middle of that ward, in that middle of that place. It felt like this. To me, it felt like Jesus was crying with us. It felt like Jesus, like when he lost his friend Lazarus, and he cried. Jesus was there with us and knew what it was like to lose a friend to death. And he was there comforting us and there strengthening us. And as we prayed together with Amy just in that space, it was like the peace of God that passes all understanding. Like Jesus was sharing our pain, like it was, he understood. Where was Jesus in the midst of Amy's passing? Where was Jesus in the midst of that? He was right there with us. He wasn't afar off. He was right there with us. He was sharing our grief, sharing our pain. He was helping us to journey through the difficult days. And the reason that Jesus relates to our suffering is because he himself suffered. He himself knew what it was to suffer. He knew what it was to experience extreme pain. He suffered himself, as we've been reminded this morning, a slow, lingering, painful death. It was an unfair death. He didn't deserve to die. He hadn't done anything that had deserved death. It was an unjust death. It wasn't justice, hadn't been seen to be done when he was put to death. And it separated him from the ones that he loved, from his heavenly Father for a period of time. It separated from his disciples. It separated from those that he loved. Isaiah chapter 53, prophetic Old Testament book written by the prophet Isaiah, looks forward down through the tunnels of time to the death of Jesus upon the cross, and he describes the suffering that Jesus undertook this way. It says this: he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Jesus suffered. He was pierced. He was crushed. He was punished, and he was wounded, also that we could enjoy this new life that he brings to us. He knew what it was to suffer. He knew what it was to face pain and to handle. And whatever you're going through today, whatever challenge, whatever frustration, whatever pain there is in your circumstances, I want to say this morning that Jesus understands. He understands what it is to suffer, and he understands what it is for you to ask him to help you to journey through that. Today is Palm Sunday. It's the Sunday before Resurrection Sunday, Easter. And as we read through the Gospels of what Jesus was doing, it's clear that there was a lot of confusion amongst his disciples. Ministry for the previous 3.5 years had been pretty clear. Gather a crowd, preach the good news of the gospel, heal the sick, blind can see, and travel around from town to town and city to city doing that. But now as the 3.5 years come to a conclusion, there's a sense of uncertainty in the air. Jesus, for a while, had been explaining the purpose to the disciples. He'd been telling them what was coming, but they hadn't understood it. They hadn't been able to grasp what was actually happening. They really had no ability to understand what he was talking about. And Jesus' talk of dying and suffering was really abhorrent to them. They're thinking, no, this can't be. And they didn't understand what would happen if what Jesus said came to pass. They'd signed up for miracles. They'd signed up for the supernatural. They'd signed up for healings and for feeding thousands. They'd signed up to be involved in this major outpouring of God's power and grace in the place. They'd signed up to overthrow the Roman Empire. That's what they'd signed up for. But here they are in this week before Easter, their world slowly falling apart. Judas begins to hatch his plan. He's going to betray Jesus for some money. Religious leaders are plotting to kill Jesus. They're getting their act together. It's all starting to come together. Yeah, guys, we can do this. The disciples are beginning to push back against Jesus and go, hey, this can't come about. No, Jesus, they hadn't signed up for pain and suffering. They didn't sign up to be persecuted. Their world slowly began to unravel and fall apart. I think we're often a little like these disciples. We simply don't understand what's happening. And that's okay. John chapter 12, as it introduces this Passion Week, this Palm Sunday, introduces us to Jesus. And Jesus, as he comes into Jerusalem, riding on a donkey, and people pull down palm branches and lay them on the road. And then in verse 16, it makes this really interesting comment about Jesus and about the disciples there. It says this in verse 16, "Now Jesus' disciples didn't understand what was taking place." Isn't it interesting, as followers of Jesus, sometimes we don't understand what is taking place? Last week, you know, as we did these funeral requirements and preparation, and sometimes people would say to me, I just don't understand. I don't understand how God could allow this. I don't understand how these circumstances, I don't understand how such a good person could have something so bad happen to them when there's so many bad people who seem to have good things happen to them. I don't understand. Now, disciples didn't understand what was taking place, but it says afterwards, but afterwards, when he was exalted into glory, they understood. Afterwards, they did. Afterwards, when the resurrection power of Jesus was involved, then they understood what was going on. And there are some things in this life that we just don't understand. There are some things. Or we all know the story of Job, don't we? Job, a man who loved God, honored God, came to church every week without fail. He did offering talks, communion talks. He even preached occasionally. Not that doing that makes you a good person. But he was a good man, and he loved God with all of his heart, and God loved him, and God had blessed him with so much stuff. And then behind the scenes, a whole thing takes place, and Job finds himself losing lots of stuff. He loses his possessions. The devil comes and strips those away. He loses his family. He loses his health. And he keeps asking these questions, why me? Why us? What have I done to deserve this? I don't understand what's going on in this place because I've served God all my life and I've trusted him and now this terrible thing has happened to me and it's happened to my family. And here's the thing, God never explains to him what's going on. You read through the whole of the book of Job and God never gives him an explanation. God never sits down. And the whole, you look at all the chapters up to like chapter 40, it's all about Job trying to understand and it's his friends saying, well, there must be sin in your life, Job, and we think we understand and there's all of this stuff going on there. There's no explanation that's given. In fact, towards the end of that book, after chapter of Job's questions, it's actually God who speaks to Job. And I love this. God says to Job, Job, look, I'm not going to answer your questions. That's really sort of not any of your business. I don't want to get you involved with this. But here, I've got some questions for you, Job, if you're so smart, if you think you can know what's going on. Where were you when I created the earth? Isn't it interesting, this perspective that changes? That all all Job wants is to understand why this calamity's happened, why this difficulty's happened in his life. But here it comes back to God. He says, well, let me ask you a question, Job. Where were you when the earth was created? Where were you when I called into being all of these things around here? Where were you when I hung the stars in the heavens? Where were you when I worked out the dimensions of the earth and I placed the sea in the container and the stars? And for four chapters, God asks Job questions and Job has no answer to the questions. In other words, Job says, mind your own business. Makila, if you could come back, please. He says, Job, I'm God and you're not. And there's some things in this life you just won't understand. Would you stand with me this morning? I'd like to pray for us. I don't have any definitive answer. And I don't even have any definitive understanding in what last week was all about. I have no definitive understanding into the suffering and the pain that so many people actually experience and go through in life. Yet I do know this. God loves us. He says he'll never leave us nor forsake us. He cares for each one of us. He feels empathy for the pain that we go through. And he's walking alongside of us. And sometimes we think if I could only understand what was going on, then it would make sense. Then I could work out my response. I could work out what I'm going to do. But I want to say this morning that sometimes it's not given to us to understand the challenges that we face, the difficulties that we walk through, or the things that are required of us. Sometimes we just don't understand. And that requires faith. Requires faith. And I think God's words to Job were, man, just trust me. Look around. If I can create the heavens and the earth, if I can call these things into being, then you can trust me that I'm going to work these things out in your world, that I love you and care for you, and I'm going to bless you and look after you. So, Father, I thank you for every person here. Lord, every person who's facing challenges, facing difficulties, who has questions and uncertainties, Lord, we give them to you this morning in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, that you are with us. Lord, you see our pain. And Lord, if we will give that pain to you, if we will turn to you instead of despair, if we'll turn to you instead of anxiety, if we'll trust you, Lord, that you are outworking your will in our life, even though it might seem like that's impossible, Lord, I believe your peace and your strength and your comfort will be there. While I was preparing this morning, I felt like the Lord prompted me that there's numbers of people here today that you've just had big disappointments in your life. And you don't understand where God was in the middle of that disappointment. Still doesn't make sense to you. And the thing that has sat upon your heart is this sense of disappointment. I expected this and somehow that didn't happen. I got much less than that and now I'm disappointed. And sometimes that disappointment can turn to despair. And sometimes that despair can turn into depression. And we can feel ourselves thinking very negatively about life and about ourselves. But I want to say this morning, if that's you, I want to encourage you just in this moment to give that disappointment to Jesus. Say, Jesus, I don't understand what that journey was about. I don't understand what that circumstance was. I don't understand what it was, why I had to go through that stuff. And Lord, it's disappointment in my world. But Lord, I give that to you today. I give you that disappointment. And Lord, I trust you. Lord, that you love me, that you'll care for me. And Lord, that you'll guard me with your peace and your strength and your encouragement, Lord, as I journey through this. So that's you this morning, just in this place. Give that disappointment to Jesus. Say, Lord, I give it to you this morning. Lord, someone that I love has gone. Lord, a relationship that I have had is broken. Lord, my financial world is not what I thought it was going to be. Lord, the friends that I thought were friends didn't turn out to be friends. And Lord, now I'm disappointed. Lord, I give it to you. Lord, I trust you. I give it to you right now. And Lord, I choose. I choose you. I choose you. So Father, I thank you for every person here this morning. Just in this moment. Let your peace and your grace and your strength fill every heart, fill every life. Lord, I thank you. Lord, as we step into this week now, I pray, Lord, your grace would go with us. I pray your strength would encourage us. Watch over us and keep each one of us safe, I ask in Jesus' name. Lord, help us, Lord, as we wrestle with some of these issues of life, Lord, to trust you in the midst of our circumstances. I commit every person into your hands now. Bless them, I pray. Lord, bless them, I pray, today in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week, and we'll be here next Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. There's always lots of visitors in Ballina on Easter Sunday, so we look forward to welcoming other people and look forward to seeing you next Sunday. God bless. Have a great afternoon.
Come.